So yesterday I was reminded by Igor Pavlovich that probably it's good to say something about normalization I use for the action of Maxwell theory. Yes, the Lagrangian and the action which I used yesterday. Maybe I will use blue. Do we have blue? Oh, this
pen,
is new.
The
one.
Blue pen is old.
It's old. Okay. Then we can use this back. So, what I was using yesterday was this normalization of the Maxwell action. F mu. And this is a normalization written in the so-called Lorentz Heaviside units. And if you look at the Landau-Lipschitz book, then you will see that normalization used there is 1 over 16 pi c integral f mu. And this is normalization in the so-called Gaussian units. And as you see, the difference between these two is a factor of 1 over 4 pi. That's the only difference between these two. And people sometimes prefer to use this normalization here because it renders the Coulomb law to look very simple. In this normalization, the Coulomb law looks like e squared divided just by r squared, while in the case of working with this action here with Lorentz Heaviside units, the Maxwell equations look simpler because they do not involve this factor of 4 pi, but this factor of 4 pi appears then in the Coulomb law. So in the Lorentz Heaviside units, you have extra 1 over 4 pi appearing in the Coulomb law, and this is 4 pi is related, of course, as you understand, with their volume of the sphere, with the surface of the sphere. Area of the sphere. Good. There are your remarks. These are remarks about what I was telling you yesterday and today. I would like to continue with the quantization of electromagnetic field. And I promised you to explain the covariant approach to the quantization of the electromagnetic field. But before I do that, I would like first to formulate the basic problem with electromagnetic field, namely, if you work out a bit this Lagrangian or this action, write down explicitly by opening up the definition of F mu, you will end up at the end with the following expression. So you have to integrate by parts. And at the end, you will obtain the following expression. So we will have a mu, and then there will be some operator looking like eta mu d rho d rho minus d mu acting on a. So you can rewrite your action in this form. And this object here, this operator, which acts on a mu, you can call it kinetic operator of the Maxwell action. And the point is that if you go to the quantum theory, the most important object or the first object you encounter is a propagator, is a Feynman propagator. And the Feynman propagator in simple words is a green function, and the green function is an inverse of the kinetic operator. This identification actually works for all fields You can consider scalar field, vector field, Dirac field, it's one and the same thing. Of course, Green's function is not unique, and you have to pick up the proper one in order to be identified really as Feynman propagator, which is a causal Green's function. It's not retarded, it's not advanced, but it's a causal Green's function. But nevertheless, the problem, the identification works in a sense that the propagator must be identified with an inverse, properly defined inverse. And for the vector field here, you encounter the big problem, because this kinetic operator is degenerate. It has a big kernel. So if you consider any function alpha, and you take this function alpha and apply to d nu alpha this kinetic operator, you will see that the result of this application will be zero. So all such vectors A mu, which has a form of d nu, all vectors d nu, which has a form of d nu alpha, are in the kernel of this operator. They are just annihilated by this operator. It's a very big kernel. You can see that this explicit. So when I take the first term here, I will get d rho d rho, d nu acting on alpha minus d mu minus d nu, which is the same as d rho acting d mu on alpha. So you will get z. So this operator has a very big kernel. And if an operator has a kernel, can we invert it? Does inverse exist? No, there is no way. You cannot define inverse of this. There is no way you can do it. So you have a problem. You don't know how to quantize. You don't know how to define the Feynman property. You don't know how to define the Green's function for this operator. And this is, of course, the source of the troubles. The main source of the troubles is the quantization of electromagnetic field. And the bird over there confirmed my words. Good. How to proceed? So one way to proceed, I already mentioned yesterday. One way to proceed is to fix the gauge. Fix a gauge. And you can do it in different ways. And basically, fixing a gauge means that you restrict allowed set of potentials. You impose a condition on a potential. So you prefer to work outside the kernel of this operator. So condition on a potential, restriction of possible gauge potentials, of possible configurations, possible field configurations. Let's put it this way. And there are many ways to do it. You can fix popular gauges, include, for instance, Hamiltonian gauge or unitary gauge, A0 equals 0. Then there is a Coulomb gauge, divergence of vector potential is equal to 0. There is also a gauge of a fixed point, which looks like this. And there are more complicated gauges, like, for instance, this one, nonlinear gauge, A mu is equal to B squared. And you can imagine other choices. Some of the gauges are good, some of them are not good, some of them complete, some of them are not complete. And they can be used in different situations for different problems. But there is another way to approach the problem. Namely, you can simply remove your gauge symmetry by deforming the action. Another approach is based on the deformation.
deformation approach. Deformation approach, and the main idea here is deform the action, deform Maxwell's theory. Such that gauge invariance is removed. Gauge invariance is removed. So there is no problem to invert kinetic operator. But Lorentz invariance is preserved. Lorentz invariance is preserved. So in other words, deformation of the action should be such, so you explicitly add some terms to the action, but in such a way that the Lorentz invariance is preserved. But you deform it, and so it's not original Maxwell action anymore, and that's why in this way of deforming the theory, you might remove the problem with gauge invariance. If you do that, you seem to be okay, but of course, then you have to answer the question, why? This deformed theory has something to do with electromagnetism. Why? This is still can make a connection, makes a connection to Maxwell. And what I'm going to do now, I'm going to discuss the very popular way to perform such a deformation, which leads me to consideration of the Lagrangian, which is due to Fermi, and sometimes people also call it Stueckelberg-type Lagrangian, where you start from the following theory. So S is given by 1 over C, integral d for x, minus 1 over 4, so again, Lorentz Heaviside units, f mu, and you add up the following deformation term, lambda over 2, d mu, a mu squared. Where lambda is just a real number, so lambda is a parameter, real parameter not equal to zero. When lambda is equal to zero, you return back to the Maxwell theory. When lambda is not zero, you can look at this action as being a deformation of the original Maxwell action, and this deformation is triggered by this parameter lambda. So Fermi idea. Now, what we have preserved with this deformation is that we preserve the following features. First of all, this action here still involves only first derivative of electromagnetic field. Second, it's quadratic in A mu, precisely as the first term, which is also quadratic in A mu, and this guy is also. So this is the one feature, and the second feature is that indices are paired, so the term I have added is explicitly Lorentz invariant. Now, you can perform the transformation A mu goes to A mu plus d mu alpha. Of course, the first term is invariant, as we know this, while the second one will undergo the following change. So d mu a mu will go to d mu a mu plus box alpha. And so indeed, for generic alpha, there will be no anymore gauge invariance. This is certainly not gauge invariant terms. And probably gauge invariance still will be for the restricted class of configurations of alpha, for those alpha which satisfy this equation, box alpha is equal to zero. If box alpha equals to zero, then still such alpha allow you to deform your potential without modifying the action. But of course, this restricts the class of possible gauge transformations a lot. This is not generic situation. And since this is not generic situation, it's kind of a singular situation, singular alphas are allowed, namely those which satisfy this equation. Since it's not generic situation, then the corresponding new kinetic operator, which is deformation of this one, becomes invertible and you can define the Feynman property. Okay, let's see what we can say further about this action. Now, apparently this action was a massless vector. There is no mass term. Massless vector. And if you forget about this non-generic gauge transformations, you see that in principle all A mu, all components of the vector potential are on equal footing. And they are all propagating degrees of freedom. All A mu propagate. There is no preference. And now what you would like to do, you would like to understand this theory and you would like to quantize it. And I remind you, the first step we did yesterday when we were discussing the scalar field, we first solved the classical equations of motion. And what I would like to do now, I would like to look at the classical equations of motion, which I get from this section, and I would like to solve them. Now, you see, if you do, if you allow yourself to throw boundary terms, if you allow yourself to integrate here by parts and throw away boundary terms, then this section can be rewritten in the following form. 1 over C d for x minus 1 half d mu a nu, d mu a nu, minus 1 half lambda minus 1 d mu a mu squared. So what I have done here, I have integrated a bit by parts here. I wrote down this term explicitly, and I integrate by parts, and I bring my action to this form by throwing away some boundary terms. By the way, from the point of the Hamiltonian formalism, adding or throwing away boundary terms corresponds to canonical transformation. This is typically canonical transformation in the Hamiltonian language. In canonical transformations, you are always allowed to do. They are not changing the Poisson structure. And now it's very easy to vary this section with respect to potential. And if you do that, you obtain the following equations of motion, which looks like box A nu plus lambda minus 1 d nu d mu a mu is equal to 0. So this is the equation of motion. And the immediate consequence of this equation is that if you apply to this equation operation d nu and sum over nu, so you add this equation with d nu, you get box d nu a nu plus lambda minus 1 box d nu
AU. I change index mu for nu here equals to zero, which produces for me the following equation. Box d mu A mu is equal to zero. So in other words,
the combination
d mu A mu satisfies wave equation. However, from here we cannot conclude that d mu A mu is equal to zero. It does not follow from here that d mu A mu is equal to zero.
It just tells you that d mu A mu must be a solution of the wave equation, but not more than that.
Wave equation can have many solutions which are non-trivial. So that means that you cannot conclude that this theory would be equivalent to the original Maxwell theory in the Lorentz gauge. This is not the case. And it's important to realize it does not follow from my consideration that d mu A mu is equal to zero, and therefore I can just omit it. This is not the case. By the way, Lorentz gauge, Lorentz gauge is a condition d mu A mu is equal to zero, and it's named after Lorentz, which is not the same as Lorentz, the man who is important for transformations of special relativity. Lorentz, who invented this gauge condition, was Ludwig Lorentz, and this is a Danish physicist. While Lorentz, Lorentz transformations, was a Dutch physicist. But in physics, there is a formula which belongs to Bohr, known as the Lorentz formula. First derived by Lorentz and then rediscovered by Lorentz. It's about dependence on the refraction index on the density of the matrix as far as I remember. The refraction on the density belongs to Bohr. Okay, good. But in whatever book you open, almost everywhere, Lorentz gauge is written not in a proper way. Okay, this is just one historical remark.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
For the creation of motion, mm-hmm. we take lambda equal to zero, we should restore a normal flux equation, right?
Yes.
Does that seem like a thing? Or is it just not obvious?
Lambda is equal to zero, yes. You restore the standard equation. So this is box minus d mu. This is Maxwell equation. So d mu f mu, which is a Maxwell equation, is totally equivalent to box a nu minus d nu d mu a mu is equal to zero. It is a Maxwell equation.
Yes.
If you open every smart, you will get this equation. Indeed. Thank you. That's a good question. Okay, and you see, of course, when I was looking at this line here, I canceled one with this term here, and then I get a product of lambda multiplied by box, and I'm assuming, of course, that lambda is not zero in order to make this conclusion. So this is for lambda not equals to zero, of course. So all what I'm doing now assumes that lambda is not zero. So I really have a deformation. Okay, so typically the story simplifies a lot, actually dramatically, if you from the very beginning choose lambda to be equal to 1. Well, you see it. It's clear already from equations of motion. If you take lambda is equal to 1, equation for a nu becomes a standard wave equation. So things simplified a lot. But actually, you heard yesterday from Christoph's talk that it's very, very useful to have lambda in the answer for the propagator, and because it allows you to control your computation. For instance, if you deal with the gauge invariants and you sum up the Feynman diagrams, individual Feynman diagrams typically are not gauge invariant. And in order to achieve gauge invariants, you need to add them up. And if you make a little mistake somewhere, then you will not get the correct result. And this parameter lambda actually allows you to control the situation. So if you have a result which really corresponds, or you think must correspond to the Maxwell theory, then the result should not depend on the deformation. So eventually you will be interested in the observables of this theory which do not depend on lambda, which would allow you to conclude that if you would get a computation in the Maxwell theory, which actually you cannot do, the result must agree because your result does not depend on lambda. So this is a trick. You deform your theory, but you are looking at the observables which do not depend on lambda. And this is where you expect to find a coincidence and agreement with the Maxwell theory. And I would like now to do all the steps rigorously and show you how this propagator arises. And this is a little bit non-trivial because you saw that this propagator has this extra term proportional to lambda. And in particular, the term in the denominator has a force power of momentum. And the question is, if you want to treat your propagator in the right way, you have to put epsilon prescription. And the question is, what is exactly the epsilon prescription for this lambda-dependent propagator? And this is something which we are going to find out. Okay, so I want to solve this equation of motion.
You wouldn't invent names for different lambdas.
I will invent them later.
Names, of course. Lambda equal to zero is Landau gauge. Lambda equal to one is Feynman gauge. And
yes.
So and so forth.
At a certain point, I will invent them.
Okay.
I will come to that. Certainly, certainly, I will come to that. But you see, in from this treatment, as I started it this way, it's not very much clear that different choices of lambda has something to do with gauges. Gauges are restrictions you impose on your field configuration. Here you don't restrict anything. You just deform the action. But people continue to call this lambda as a gauge fixing term and call it gauge. For Landau, it will be the gauge. You will see it. I will show you that this is really the gauge. But for other lambda, I don't know. Good. So let's move a little bit in the direction of the Hamiltonian formalism, because I would like also to show you the Hamiltonian for this theory. So we can compute canonical momentum, which this time I denote by p mu, because I will never get, I will get at a certain point mass shell relation, but okay, there will be no confusion. So canonical momentum means that I need to take my Lagrangian and vary it with respect to the velocity of A mu. And if you do that, you will obtain the following answer. A mu dot minus eta mu 0, where eta is Minkowski metric, lambda minus 1 over c squared, A0 dot plus c di ai. Such a long expression. Now, of course, again, you see that since immediately simplified lambda is equal to 1, you don't get the scale, but for general lambda, you get it. And now I will tell you a general thing. If you would like the simplest way to construct the Hamiltonian formalism with a canonical symplectic structure is to do the following trick. Since now you know your canonical momentum, you take your Lagrangian, and you represent it in the following form. You write it as an integral p mu on x a mu dot. So that means that you have here, the term, like in mechanics, PQ dot. And then you subtract from this expression here all what you can subtract in order to find the original Lagrangian. So I call it rest. Whatever you need to add in order to reproduce the original Lagrangian. So what I mean by this is that you simply substituted here the definition of P mu, and so you will get some expression, and then you find this rest simply by saying that the rest is equal to P A dot minus original Lagrangian. So this way of obtaining Hamiltonian formalism, constructing the canonical Hamiltonian formalism, is called, sometimes it's called first order formalism. First order formalism. It's very powerful, simple, and efficient. So I'm just doing what you normally do in the usual mechanics. Now, so what is the rest? The rest is, of course, must be H. If you write it, if you remove A mu dot in terms of canonical momentum. And so in our case, if you do this computation, you find for the Hamiltonian the following answer. H is 1/2 integral, three-dimensional integral dx. And here you have minus c squared over lambda, p zero squared, minus 2c lambda minus 1 over lambda, p zero di at I, plus c squared di squared, and then bunch of terms in the a. Di at 0 plus di at j. Di at j. And the last term, lambda minus 1 over lambda, di at I squared. This is the Hamiltonian. And this Hamiltonian, this kinetic term here, PQ dot, simply tells you that you have canonical Poisson structure. P mu x, comma A mu on y should be equal to delta mu mu, delta function, three-dimensional delta function of x minus y. And again, I remind you that this Poisson bracket is equal time Poisson bracket. So there is no time dependent on the right-hand side. And the time variable for P mu and A mu is the one and the same. So it's equal time Poisson bracket. So now you can check that original equations of motion written down here are equivalent to the standard Hamiltonian equations. A mu dot is equal to Poisson bracket of H with A mu, and B mu dot is given by H. Well, when you look at this Hamiltonian here, you will see that it has one annoying and unpleasant feature. Namely, it's not quite diagonal, because there is this here cross term where you have momentum interacting with coordinates, so it's like px. Hamiltonian, of course, you can have it. It's just what you have. The point is that is it possible to do some canonical transformation which might allow you to get rid of such terms and make your Hamiltonian diagonal? Because if it's diagonal, then it's easy to quantize it. And it appears that the answer is no. If you try to find such a canonical transformation, you will fail. There is no time-independent canonical transformation which allow you to get rid of such a term. There is always a mix in this Hamiltonian. Although it's quadratic in fields, but the fields are mixed.
And my statement is that there is no canonical transformation, time-independent canonical transformation. There is no time-independent canonical transformation which removes the mixing. Maybe there is a time-dependent canonical transformation, but actually I failed to find it. Spend some time on this, but I was not able to find it.
Good. But there is a way to proceed to understand the structure of the theory in a direct way by solving equations of motion.
Simply by solving equations of motion and then developing the quantization procedure from this direction. So if you allow me, can I clean this blackboard? Do you have it? Mm-hmm. If you have questions, please ask me.
That is very usual definition how to proceed from Lagrangian to Newtonian. So why do you stress that?
I stress
so fantastic to it. It's well known. Or what is behind all those?
Behind is this relation here. This relation immediately tells you that you have a canonical boson structure. Uh-huh. If you have a very complicated Lagrangian, how do you know what is the boson structure?
Oh.
How you find it? And if when you want to construct the Hamiltonian. And the way I do, it tells you immediately that it should be like this. You know, if you do field redefinitions, you can, of course, change your phase variables. And in general, you also change the boson structure because you introduce new variables. Only canonical transformations are those which preserve the boson structure. So this is minor, very minor remark, that it allows you immediately to identify the boson structure. That's the only thing I wanted to say. It's called first order homology. You can call it the standard way.
May I ask the question?
Sure.
And why boson structure can be different from this? Because as I know, this is something like standard thing. And is there another possibility?
Change your variables. In general, boson structure will change. You have some phase space. You can coordinate. You can introduce coordinates in many different ways. All of them can be good, related to each other by nonlinear redefinition. In general, if you pick up some arbitrary coordinate system, which is related to this one by some complicated transformation, this coordinate system, Poisson bracket, will look differently. Only those transformations which preserve this bracket, they constitute a group, and this is what is known and under the name the group of canonical transformations. We like it because canonical transformations, because sometimes canonical transformations allow you, without changing the boson structure, to change the Hamiltonian and bring it to a very simple form. Equational motion still remains a Hamiltonian, the same, but if the Hamiltonian becomes simple, you can solve your equations, and then you perform inverse transformation and return back to the original problem.
And what we get from boson structure?
Dynamical equations, equations in the Hamiltonian form. Then equations are written like this.
I see.
So you have this Hamiltonian. Now you can forget about Lagrangian description totally. And I say, I take my Hamiltonian, I have this Poisson bracket, I form the right-hand side, and this is my Hamiltonian equation. That's it. They are totally equivalent to this a set of these second-order differential equations. Good. Solving field equations. So now what I will do, I will start with a standard way of writing my field in terms of a Fourier integral dk, and I put here a square root of 2c modulus of k. I put this factor for convenience here, and then there will be some Qli, let me write it as a Qli a mu, dependent on tk and exponential ikx. You see, of course, I don't know how my potential depends on time. A dependence on time is precisely determined by this nonlinear equation. But what I can always do, I can fix a moment of time and I can expand my A mu into Fourier integral over special components of momentum. That I can always do. It's just expansion of a three-dimensional time. For any function, I can do that, which has, well, formally, I can do it for any function, formally. Now I take this and plug into this equation here and obtain a system of equations, because now, well, here of course you see I have four equations for each component of nu. Nu is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3. So I have four equations here, and these four equations now are taken the following form for this purely potential. I will get the following equation, purely A minus I lambda minus 1 C KI AI dot equals 0, and for this I have AI double dot plus C squared squared AI plus I lambda minus 1 C KI A0 dot plus lambda minus 1 C squared KI KJ A purely J is equal to 0. So you see now all derivatives with respect to special directions are gone. They are replaced by the explicit appearance of this vector k, ki. So k squared. Yes. Let me see. So here a zero index is missing. Thank you. Yes. And okay, so have a look at this equation. Here there is also this index I. You see that it's convenient to introduce annotation to denote by chi, this combination kj aj, to introduce such a function which is kj aj, and then the first equation simply becomes lambda a0 double dot minus I lambda minus 1 c chi dot plus c squared k0 squared k0 equals to 0, and chi double dot. Now what I do, I take these three equations here and I multiply them with ki. I contract them with ki. When I contract them with ki, I will get my function chi appearing like this: a zero squared chi is equal to zero. And actually, now I have to tell you what is k zero, because I introduced a new letter which was not there before. After now, there is no k zero in the game. There was only a square of the vector k squared, but now I introduce extra notation, so I denote this by k0 squared, for the reason you will see it later. I will drive to the dispersion relation for photons. It will naturally appear from these considerations. Okay, so this is what follows from this system. Here again is zero.
So this is a system of ordinary differential equations, but it's coupled. So you have two functions, a0 and chi, and you have ordinary differential equation with respect to time variable. But this is a system still, and you need to solve it. Of course, you can apply here the method of Green's functions and develop Green's functions, try to solve it, but there is a much simpler way to do it. Much simpler way. Namely, when you look at this for some time, stare at it, you realize that it's very natural to pick up the following answers. Minus I omega t, h0 plus at, and chi, the same exponent, minus I omega t, u plus bt, where h0, a, u, and b are four unknown constants, and t is a time variable. So basically, it's a standard exponent which you expect sooner or later to appear here to accompany this special exponent depending on special directions of k. Sooner or later, you expect it to appear, but the new feature is that you have to allow more general time dependence, in particular linear dependence on time. So you take these ansatz, you plug it in, and I will not bother you with solving these linear equations. You can solve them, no problem. It's just linear algebra. You allow me to remove this equation. You have it, right? This is basic equation of motion. This equation we are solving now. We solve this equation and we find the following answer. So coefficients a and b are uniquely fixed and found to be IC lambda minus 1, lambda plus 1, H0, K0 plus U. Coefficient B is determined minus IC K0, lambda minus 1, lambda plus 1, H0, K0 plus U. And moreover, omega gets fixed. This parameter omega, let me say that you have five unknowns. Omega is also unknown here. You also put it in the ansatz. So you have five unknowns, and upon substituting this ansatz here, omega also gets determined. And you find for omega two possibilities. So omega equals to plus minus C modulus of Kz. But modulus of K0 is a positive thing because modulus of K0 is for me, it's square root of K square. So but for omega, I find two possibilities, plus minus CK0. And finally, you need to solve these equations, not only this system. This system follows from this one, but these equations are more general because they involve three AIs. Finally, what you need to do, you need to make an ansatz for AI, which is of the same nature, minus I omega t HI, some constants, plus RI multiplied by t, where RI is also unknown. And if you pick up
Let me pick up one of these solutions. So I take omega to be c k0, where k0 is assumed to be positive. If I pick up this omega, then coefficient ri standing in front of this time dependence here also gets solved from this system now. And you find it to be ki over k0 squared multiplied by b. If the coefficient b has been already determined. Good, and now I can combine all what I have.
May I ask something?
Sure.
Well, say for the equation for AI for the substitution.
Mm-hmm.
There's some mixture of lower and upper indices. But I guess it's still important.
It's important, yes. Here, of course, indices of the special directions, which correspond to 1, 2, 3, they raise a little under the rule. Ai is equal to minus ai.
Yeah, but in that equation, you have like set of ai.
Yes, yes, yes. It means that if I get it down, then I should put here minus sign. I'm taking care of this fact. Sure, you can write it all with low indices. My chi was determined with upper index. So if you want to find from this equation, equation for chi, you have to multiply it with ki with upper index in order to get chi. Chi is here is the same as ki ai. So you lower down this index and you raise up this one. Both produce minuses and which cancel.
What I'm worried about is that some terms are with I lower and some terms are with I upper.
Does not matter. I can write it like this. Okay? If you prefer this, please write it this way. It's very good that you keep up the track of indices. Thank you. Yeah, we can write everything in a nicer way. We can hold indices down, but then, of course, we have to worry about minuses. Okay, so what is not determined from these considerations are the constants h0 and hi. So a, b gets determined. I have a red marker to make them now red because we determine them. A, b, and ri are all determined. So all these linear type dependents get determined, but h0 and hi are not determined. And now my solution for a0 and ai looks as follows. Minus I omega t, where omega is given by this formula here, h0 plus I h mu k mu. I write it now in a nice way, lambda minus 1 divided by lambda plus 1 ct, and the ai on tk is equal to exponential minus I omega t hi plus I h mu k mu ki divided by k0 lambda minus 1 lambda plus 1 ct. This is a solution. And you see that you can actually nicely combine these formulas into a single formula, namely a mu on tk is equal to exponential minus I omega t multiplied by some, I'm in shortage of proper letters. And let's write it as a u mu. Where this u mu is the following universal combination. H mu plus I h mu k mu, k mu divided by k 0, lambda minus 1, lambda plus 1, ct. Okay, this is a solution of this problem. Where H's now, in a sense, are analogous to amplitudes.
this can depend on k, on the three-dimensional vector k, and these are undetermined amplitudes analogous to creation annihilation operators. They remain to be undetermined. Okay. Good. And now what you have to do, you have to write down the generic solution. Now, actually, my statement is that my ansatz is not really an ansatz. Actually, I found the most general solution because what you see here are the equations which are of the second order in time, so they must have two independent solutions. And one solution will correspond to the positive frequency, and another will correspond to negative frequency. So in this way, that means that I solved my equations by superposing these solutions with positive and negative frequency. And frequency actually is k0 squared, k0, so you see, what I have derived, in fact, what I have is precisely the dispersion relation for photons. What is standing here can be understood as k0, but k0 is square root of k squared, so it's precisely the dispersion for photons. K0 squared minus k squared is equal to 0. Good, and now I don't need these equations anymore. I'll show you how this analysis is performed. All what I'm telling you, you don't find in the books. At least I failed to find this.
Is now there any meaning of this vector U?
I introduce for convenience in order not to write all the time this expression here. So I will write for you just a general solution now for Emil.
It's interesting that lambda equal to zero is well there.
Lambda equals to zero kills this piece. That's why everything what I'm telling
lambda
you is
equal to one.
Oh, sorry, lambda is equal to one.
But
yes.
Lambda equal to zero is allowed.
Is allowed, yeah. Is allowed.
Well, it's not trivial, right? Because you started from what was not allowed and the solution is allowed.
At this point, yes. But at a certain point, you will see that you will not put it to zero. You will have some singularities. You will see it in a second. Mm-hmm. Here you can have it, but then later you will see that it's...
Otherwise it would be great.
At a certain point, you will run into the problem. And probably I will point out where. Yeah, I will show you where you will run into the problem. That's a very good point. Thank you. Mm-hmm. By the way, lambda equals to minus one should also bring your attention. Right? No, the point which you should actually keep in mind is the following. When I'm saying that these amplitudes are allowed to depend on k, they also allow to depend on lambda. There is nothing which tells me that they cannot be lambda independent. They depend on everything, on all parameters which you have in your theory a priori. So, yes, in principle, there is a lambda dependence, so you will see that it will be one. Okay. So, from this expression, you cannot really conclude.
Sorry.
Yes. So, these are like integration constants. For me, lambda is like just a parameter which sits in my equations. So all my integration constants, which are these h's, can depend on this parameter a priori. Nothing tells me that that should not be the case. Yeah. So for me, this meaning of this you knew, as you will see, it will be like a generalized oscillator, non-trivial oscillator, and I will show you how to build this. So a mu on x is then given by c divided by 2 pi 3 over 2. Integral dk square root of 2 omega. Omega is determined now. It's always positive for me.
I pick up a positive thing. But now I add up these two solutions. So one is u nu on tk multiplied by negative frequency ak hex plus another u mu star tk multiplied by the positive frequency ak x. And this is a real field. So this u mu is complex conjugate of this. And this is the most general solution. So now kx here is k0 x0 minus kx. So I combined these exponents here with the exponents dependent on the special vector k. So this is the most general solution. And analogously, you can build up a similar expression for p mu on x. There will be a similar expression. Yeah, I can just give it to you. Because p mu, you remember, p mu was determined from its definition via a dot. But there was this long formula, you remember. You just apply it to this solution a mu, and you will get the following answer. I over c integral dk over 2 pi 3 over 2 square root omega over 2. And then you have some b mu on tk, quite analogous to what you see here, minus akx minus b mu star on tk exponential ikx, where this b mu is a bit complicated beast, analogous to u mu. And it's given by the following formula, h mu plus k mu h mu divided by k 0 squared, lambda minus 1, lambda plus 1, 2 eta mu k 0 minus k mu 1 minus I k 0 c t. Okay, that is a full solution for a and b. Good. And now you can do the following. You can do the same procedure as you do, for instance, for the usual scalar field. You can bring the commutation relations between basic fields b nu a nu to the set of oscillators which you have, to this H's. So in other words, what you can do, you can solve these equations back for first u mu and b mu to express them via a and p. And then if you know u mu and b mu via a and p, you can, since you know expression for u and b in terms of h, you can solve for h in terms of a and p. So the next step is to solve for, from these equations, h mu on kt and h mu star on kt in terms of a and p. So basically, that is always possible to do because here you have eight unknowns, four H's and four H star. So four unknowns, four plus four gives you eight unknowns, but you also get eight equations. This is four equations and four equations here. So you can always solve this algebraic system. And when you solve it, then you know your H and H star in terms of your basic canonical variables, and you compute the bracket between between h's. And so this is the answer now for the bracket. This is the answer you will find for the bracket upon this computation.
Okay. Poisson bracket, and what I do, I immediately quantize it by replacing it with a commutator. So allow me to write down already quantum version, and you can enjoy by its simplicity and its nice form. Ega k prime is equal to minus h bar delta k minus k prime multiplied by matrix M G nu, where matrix M nu appears to have the following form. It's a constant matrix which has the following matrix elements. Zeros here, and here minus delta ij plus ki kj divided by 2 k0 squared lambda minus 1 over lambda. So this is the answer for the canonical, for the structure, for the commutator of H and H dagger, which you inherit from canonically quantizing this Poisson bracket. So this bracket is replaced by the commutator, and in front you get minus I H bar. So you canonically quantize and get this structure. And now it looks like you're not anymore can consider the limit lambda to zero. It's a bit problematic. It becomes problematic. But lambda is equal to one gives you the standard Minkowski metric, by the way. Lambda is equal to one brings you to Minkowski situation. You get one here and you get minus delta ij in this block. So you get the standard Minkowski for lambda is equal to 1. If you wish, you can also compute the determinant of this matrix. Determinant is also very simple. I don't know actually why I'm computing it, but that's for lambda squared, lambda plus 1 squared. I'll just to show you explicitly this. Any questions here? Is my logic is clear?
I don't really understand. What if we put lambda zero before writing that matrix?
We can, then we get back to the Maxwell theory, which we don't know what to do.
Okay.
Now we deform it, but we cannot return back. There is no return. Cannot put lambda to zero now.
You said that we will come up with a problem, but there's okay.
For lambda not equal to zero, there is no problem. There is well-defined Poisson structure, and everything looks as it's supposed to look. But I can do actually better. Namely, what I can do, I can say now that I'm looking for the following change of variables. So I'm trying now to write H mu k, where the set of standard oscillators, and analogously for H mu dagger on k, sum from r is equal to 0 to 3, H mu dagger r on k, a r dagger on k. So I'm trying now to find a field redefinition to the set of oscillators A R and A R dagger, such that the commutation relation between these oscillators are of the following type: minus H bar Minkowski metric R S delta function K minus K prime. Okay. So you see what I want to transform myself from this set of H's to this set of oscillators, satisfying even simpler commutation relation, where on the right hand side you have Minkowski metric. And so this
commutation relation in this respect is Lorentz covariant. It looks like a Lorentz covariant object. Lorentz covariant. Okay, and so what you do then? You take this definition here, and you substitute it in this bracket and use the commutation relation between oscillators, and then you find the relation between this matrices H and the matrix M. So matrix M and matrices H must satisfy the following relation. Minkowski metric H mu R H mu S should produce for me this matrix M mu mu. So this is the equation, or this is a restriction of matrices H, which is imposed this commutation relation for A's. Now I want to solve this equation for the matrix H. So this is what imposed when I substitute this decomposition, this expansion back into my commutator and use this canonical relation for this. Then I find this equation here. Actually, I'm assuming even that matrix H is real. Sorry, I'm assuming that it's real. So H dagger is equal to H. That's why there appears H squared. One H from here and another H from here. So I'm looking solution for real matrix. I want it to be even real. So I want a lot. Yes. And if I want that, then it gives me the following restriction on the matrix H. Yeah. Now you immediately see that this equation does not define my matrix H uniquely. So all what I can do, so I can take my matrix H and multiply it from the right by any Lorentz transformation. And Lorentz transformation, I remind you, this is a matrix which satisfies the following conditions. So HRS lambda R mu lambda S mu is equal to eta mu nu. This is a transformation which preserves Minkowski metric. Okay. And so that means that I need to find a particular solution of this equation, and then multiplying it from the right by any Lorentz transformation will give me a generic solution of this problem.
And while on the right, it looks as if you had to multiply it on the left.
Because, yeah, it depends on how
if you take the situation in the box.
No.
Then it can be rewritten H transpose at RS S. So if you multiply by lambda on the left, then due to the invariance of the network under the Lorentz transform, it's obvious, but.
No, it's not
multiplication from the right is not obvious.
No, be careful, be careful. Here you should be really, really be careful, because it depends on what how you define this product H now. So let me see. This is H mu 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 lambda lambda. Let's see. I multiply it from the right, right? So mu lambda. Lambda R, and that's why the index R will be acting on this
in your notation.
In my notation,
yes,
that goes this way.
Yes.
That's why I'm saying,
excuse me, so
no, it's okay. Yeah, when I look for the first time at this equation, I always conclude that I should right. So H lambda K, which you find in this way, is a particular solution which looks like 3 lambda, 3 plus 1 over 4 lambda, Kj over in 0, lambda minus 1 divided by 4 lambda, Ki, divided by k zero, lambda minus one divided by four lambda, delta ij minus k I k j k zero squared lambda minus one divided by four lambda. Okay, and then on the right we multiply it by arbitrary Lorentz transformation.
Greg, it's a small joke. You combine once more two Lorentz in two Lorentz names in one formula, right? Lorentz
transformation.
So it happened second time in history.
Second time in history, that's right. Good. Now you can ask me actually what you get for the Hamiltonian. In terms of this standard creation annihilation operators, well, this is a separate discussion why I'm calling them standard, what I would expect from them. But let's assume that I'm following this line of arguing. And now, since I know how my P and A are solved in terms of H, and H's are solved in terms of A's, I can substitute all this information into the Hamiltonian and ask myself how the Hamiltonian looks like. And this is the answer. So the Hamiltonian then will take the following form. D3k, omega on k, some matrix, let me call it, well, I have a gothic name for this letter, but I don't want to use gothic names here. Okay, let's denote it by P, capital, P mu, lambda, mu r, lambda, mu s, r, dega r, on k, r s, on k. This is how the Hamiltonian looks like, where this lambda is inherited from this freedom. It's arbitrary for the moment, arbitrary matrix of Lorentz transformation. And P mu is a concrete, very concrete matrix. So P is a concrete object, which looks like minus lambda plus one, two lambda minus ki over k zero, lambda minus one over two lambda, and here minus ki over k0, lambda minus 1 over 2 lambda, delta ij plus kij, k0 squared, lambda minus 1 over lambda. Okay? This is what you get for the matrix. So this is explicitly 4 by 4 matrix. 4 by 4. This is how your Hamiltonian looks like. And now you see, you still have a freedom in your theory. And in fact, this freedom is a freedom to do Lorentz transformations. You can pick up any Lorentz transformation. And of course, it's related to the fact that here you have a product of H by oscillators R. And this expression here is invariant with respect to Lorentz transformations. So Lorentz transformations are canonical transformations which are allowed. And that's why this freedom is flowing around. This is a freedom to do Lorentz transformation of A's. They are not uniquely defined by this relation here. What I mean is very simple. I mean that if I take AR and redefine it for AR prime by this transformation AR lambda A lambda, or other way around, it's better to write it like A lambda 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 R, then these relations will not be changed. Because on the right-hand side, you have the standard Lorentz metric, which is preserved by Lorentz transformations. So lambda is still floating around. And now, what I would like to do, I would like to find such a lambda which makes my Hamiltonian simple. Okay, I'll give you some time to think about this. Something puzzles you. Muscles?
Well, no, I just was thinking, would it be possible to fix some frame at the very beginning to write down some expressions and make some Lorentz boost from that particular frame and to get immediately that result? Or that is not really possible?
I don't know the answer, you see. Well, still, you see, lambda reflects a freedom for me. I'm doing, it's an internal freedom. In a sense, that I can do canonical transformations, and as I told you, canonical, symplectic structure stays the same. It will not be changed. Still given by this formula, but the Hamiltonian will be changed.
Yeah, sure.
And that's what you see here. So explicit dependence on this lambda. Now the question is, can I pick up my lambda in a nice form, such a form that I can get something simple? So what I need now is to pick up some lambda which simplifies me this matrix.
For instance, yes.
For instance, and then I get something reasonable. And so the answer is yes, you can find a simplification. You can pick up a particular lambda, which brings your Hamiltonian to the most simple form. You cannot make it simpler. I tried, and this is my conclusion. I don't want to write lone analysis here. I just give you the outcome. There is a particular lambda, which brings H to a very simple form, or to the possible simplest form, possible, most to the just to the simplest form. Simplest form. And this form is as follows. H is given by the following expression. D3k omega 1k. And then you have these oscillators. A1 beta A1 plus A2 beta A2 plus A3 beta A3 minus A0 beta A0 plus lambda minus 1 over 2 lambda A0 beta minus A3 beta A0 minus A0. I could not find simpler. This is what you get. So now I completely quantize this funny deformed theory, and this Hamiltonian now should be supplemented with this commutation relation on the left hand side of the blackboard, which is given by this formula, minus h theta rs delta function k minus k prime.
Which Lorentz frame is it? Is it not the Sikorsky frame?
Yeah, it's related to the Sikorsky frame.
Sikorsky frame should be.
That's true. It's so H mu can be written via Sikorsky frame, but this is a bit non-trivial. It involves also lambda. So there is some. You can write everything in terms of Sikorsky. That is actually true. Yes. So taking lambda to be standard Sikorsky, it's not quite so, but still the answer can be written in terms of. No, that is actually true. Yes. So lambda is the standard case where index r now runs all possible values. So 0, 1, 2, 3, and mu is. I'll show you the Kinsky matrix. Actually, Christoph already showed that. It's exactly the Kinsky matrix which we can transform. But this is a Hamiltonian which you get. And so for any lambda which is away from 0, you have a mixing between the oscillators and you can never unmix. So what I have, what I did, I wrote the most general transformation for lambda, and with most general transformation, you can show that you can never suppress this mix between the time component of a photon well, let's call this photon, it's a massless vector field, it's not a photon, but okay, call it photon, between the time-like and the longitudinal. Time-like and longitudinal are present and mixed. But in case of lambda is equal to 1, you get this Hamiltonian, which has another problem by itself, because as you see from this expression, this Hamiltonian is not positive definite. And this is a standard problem you encounter in the Lorentz covariant quantization of this theory. The Hamiltonian thus obtained is not Lorentz invariant. Is not positive definite. Of course, it's not Lorentz invariant, but because it's a Hamiltonian,
that's also true.
It's not Lorentz invariant and it's not positive definite. By the way, sometimes people say that it's Lorentz invariant if you put lambda is equal to 1. This is, of course, not true. Although you see here the four interval, like looking like four interval, but of course it will change under Lorentz transformations in a non-trivial way. So, of course, this is a Hamiltonian. Time direction is fixed, so you cannot do boosts. And the way to proceed with this theory is to quantize it by means of Gustav-Leuler, by the method of Gustav-Leuler. And I'm not sure if you are familiar with this.
We have something for you.
Sure. Yes.
Stop. We will take a question about this the combination of H nu to AR.
Yeah, it's like a change of the basis, right?
Yes, so the question is, these are all operators, right?
These are operators and these are functions.
Ah, okay, yeah, no, okay.
Functions. These are normal functions and these are operators and these are operators.
Okay.
So I'm like making a change of the operator basis with the help of no usual functions. Now, you see, of course, when you look at this theory, you feel that it's ill-defined because, and this is for the right reason, that the Hamiltonian is not positive definite. This oscillators contribute negatively into the energy. And of course, you now can blame for this feature the fact that you have too many quanta. In electromagnetism, you would have only A1 and A2, which would contribute positively, but here you have this A3 and A0. And normally, you know that you remove this artificial or, how to say, unwanted excitations by imposing the Lorentz gauge condition. At least you can remove one of the quanta. For instance, typically you remove time-like photons by imposing the condition d mu a mu equals to 0, which is, I remind you, is a Lorentz gauge condition. This is what you typically do. Here, however, you cannot impose this condition at the operator level. So if you quantize your theory and mu here becomes an operator, and you cannot put this combination d mu a mu to 0 as an operator. And this is what I will explain to you now. If you now take our solution for a mu and you compute it in terms of oscillators, you will find that it's equal to minus I over lambda C 2 pi q integral dk over square root of 2 omega on k, right? K mu, and then I write canonical Philbin, canonical one, the same, absolutely the same, which Christoph used in his lectures. A r on k, exponential minus I k x, exponential. A positive exponential. Like this. Okay? Thank you. And the point is that why you cannot impose this Lorentz gauge condition on the operatorial level on this quantization, in this quantization procedure, is that if you commute p mu on x
with a nu on y, you will find that this commutator is never zero. What you will find here is I h bar divided by lambda d over d x mu delta function x minus y. This is not equal time commutation relation. This is a commutator which I computed at different times. Now by using the knowledge of explicit solution for P and A in terms of oscillators, and when I compute the left hand side, I find that the right hand side is given by this one. And already here you see a peculiarity of the gauge. Famous gauge lambda goes to zero. Lambda goes to infinity. For the Landau case, Landau gauge, lambda going to infinity, you kill up this operator explicitly by the presence of 1 over lambda in the denominator, and simultaneously you kill the right hand side here. So the gauge condition appears to be possible to impose at the operatorial level in this limit. And in principle, it's also clear from the action, because in the action, you have this term lambda over 2 a mu a mu squared. When you send lambda to infinity, this term gives you the dominant contribution to the energy, actually the infinite contribution, which in fact is understandable, which actually forces d mu a mu to go to zero, otherwise your energy blows up. But what is very interesting is to look at this gauge to your Hamiltonian. Hamiltonian is not simplified. Lambda to infinity. Mixing is there. It's all the time you have this mixing term. It disappears only when lambda is a complete. The Landau gauge, the Hamiltonian, is not diagonal. No simplification happens like this. It remains to be lambda. One half of this will remain.
And then we equal to 1 is Feynman gauge, and that is Feynman typically gauge. Written in all textbooks.
And this is, this is a textbook, and this is what I get
from the
That's right. So you can never diagonalize it. That's my statement. Very simple statement.
Yeah,
whatever you do, generically, it's not diagonal. For generic lambda. For generic lambda, it's never diagonal. No, good. And then you continue with the Gupta-Bleuler procedure. And how much time do I have? Still 15 minutes.
Well, I think 10 minutes. But
10 minutes. Maybe. Okay.
It depends whether you want to keep some time for questions.
That's right. So Gupta-Bleuler, I will just tell you very, very quickly, is that now, since you cannot impose this condition at the operatorial level, what you typically do, you take your Fourier a mu on k, Fourier image a mu on k, and now it's split into positive and negative frequency modes. And what you impose a condition on your states of this type, k mu, a mu minus on k is equal to z. So in other words, the Gupta-Bleuler procedure imposes the restrictions not on the operators, but it imposes restrictions on states in the Hilbert space, states in the Hilbert space are selected such that the norm of these states will become positive. And this is related, of course, to the fact that now you, in this quantization procedure, if you start with all these oscillators, which in addition to the transverse oscillators contain time-like and longitudinal excitations, you construct a very big Hilbert space, because now you allow to act on your vacuum with a 0, a 3, and you create a lot of states. And among the states, there are states which have negative norm, which is, of course, very bad, because you don't want to deal with negative norm states.
you cannot defy property probability, and so on and so forth. And well, it's also related to the fact that for time like photon sphere, you have wrong commutation relations. For creation annihilation operator, you get here minus. While for space like oscillators, you get the standard plus in front. So your time like oscillators do not obey the standard quantization rules. And as a result, if you start forming states by acting on the vacuum with a time like oscillators, you will start to create, because of that commutation relation, you start to create states with negative norm. If you compute a norm of such a state here, you will find that it's negative. Because what you need to do in order to compute it, you need to commute these oscillators, but you have a wrong sign in front. Here you will get minus, and as a result, the norm of such a state will be negative. So by state, exactly, I mean the following state like f, one particle state being some function f on k multiplied with a zero dagger on k acting on a vacuum. So if I compute the norm of such a state, norm squared, which you expect to be positive, you will be frustrated because it will appear to be negative. So this is a Hilbert space with indefinite metric. That is what we call indefinite metric. And therefore, your Hilbert space is too big. It contains unwanted states which have negative norm. Don't want states. And so the idea of Buxte and Euler is to project them out, to impose some constraints which project such bad states out. And you leave at the end only with states of positive norm. And so their proposal is to introduce objects like L minus, A0 minus S3, and L minus dagger, which is A0 dagger minus A3 dagger. And the condition to impose is L minus on K, which is equivalent to what I'm saying here. L minus on K acting on a physical state is equal to zero. So only those states which satisfy this constraint are allowed. Physical states. And this is, in fact, equivalent if you compute k mu a mu with our solution for k mu, you will find that this is precisely the negative frequency part of expression for k mu a mu. Now, why this is compatible condition? That's because L minus on k commutes for different k's. So you can impose them simultaneously. This commutator is always to zero. And actually, very nicely is that L minus on k commutes with L minus dagger on k prime. These two things also commute. It might seem surprising, but this is the case. And this is precisely due to the fact that time-like photons have a negative sign on the right-hand side of their commutation relation. So you can check that this is what you find. Okay, if I do it very quickly, then this is like A0 minus A3, comma A0 dagger minus A3 dagger, like this. A0, A dagger is minus 1, and A3, A3 dagger is plus 1, so you get 0, you see. And then solution for phi, generic solution for phi, can be written as follows. 1 plus sum from n is equal 1 to infinity, sum function f on k1 and so on, kn, product of I from 1 to n, from 1 to n, dki
I divided by some unessential factor, L minus dagger on AI, acting on a state which is constructed only from the transverse oscillators.
So this is how solution of this equation here looks like. Generic solution to this equation. It's a generic solution to this equation. By the way, you see that if you apply to such a state your Hamiltonian, and the Hamiltonian unfortunately I deleted, but you remember that there was this additional term lambda minus 1 to lambda a0 dagger minus a3 dagger a0 minus a3. And this is nothing else as L minus, and this is nothing else as L minus dagger. And L minus supposed to annihilate state, so that's why the presence of this term, although your Hamiltonian is non-diagonal, but it becomes diagonal on the states, on the subspace of Hilbert space, satisfying this condition. That's very good. And finally, this is not the end of the story, because it appears that...
And physical degrees of freedom somehow compensate each other, right?
Yeah, in a way they still go away. They are present in your Hamiltonian, so Hamiltonian for generic lambda is mixed, but physically...
One to cancel another.
Yeah, so... Okay, I will make a comment, but let me finish with this. So one small remark here is the following. That, yeah.
A function f depends on k four-dimensional vector or three-dimensional vector?
Here, these vectors are three-dimensional. Everything is three-dimensional. Oscillators always depend on three-dimensional vector. Time is gone forever.
Omega.
No time, no omega. Omega is determined through the dispersion relation. Oh, this is the omega. But it's determined completely. And the last point is that, unfortunately, this is not the end of the story. Although you remove negative norm states, but among these states, still there are states which have zero norm. If, for instance, you consider a state L minus dagger acting on phi or on vacuum, which is allowed to be created because it's annihilated by L minus, right? Because L minus commute with L minus dagger and you get zero. But this is a creation operator, it's not annihilation. Yeah? So my statement is that such a state, L minus dagger on zero, it has a zero norm because if you make a conjugate of it, L minus, then L minus will successfully commute with L minus dagger, hit the vacuum and gets produced from zero. So you need to remove 2 degrees of freedom, time-like and longitudinal. So the first procedure removes for you time-like. But you are left with zero norm states. And in the book tabular, you simply say that the final, and actually physical, what you call physical Hilbert space, is obtained by imposing. So let me write a physical as the following subspace in the Hilbert space. So psi belongs to the physical Hilbert space. If it's killed by the vector by the operator L minus, and you consider the states modulo the zero norm states. In other words, you come to the factor space, where you agree not to distinguish between two states if they differ from each other by a state which has a zero norm. So this is a factor space.
So psi, which satisfies this equation, is the same as a state which is different from psi by a state phi which has zero. And in the modern language of Bereski quantization, this will be replaced by a statement. The first one is that u psi is equal to zero. And if I don't have time, I will come to Bereski. And this statement here is replaced that psi is not q of something. It's a modern expression of what I told you about the old Gupta-Blever story.
And in an Hungarian case, it would be related to Gribov-Kopis.
Oh, Gribov-Kopis, it's a Coulomb gauge artifact in the non-Hungarian case. If you try to impose the Coulomb gauge, then you are in trouble because you cannot really impose because of the existence of various solutions. It's a Gribov-Kopis, yes. Okay, so propagator for electromagnetic, for this funny list, funny theory is what discussed was in Christoph lecture of yesterday, and I will just repeat it. Unfortunately, I have no time to derive it. It's a very nice story about how to actually derive this propagator. I, eta, mu, okay, that's what we put here in this comment, minus I exponential I kx, and here there will be eta mu minus lambda minus 1 over lambda k mu k mu divided by k squared plus I epsilon, and this is the right way to put mu I epsilon in this propagator. What I want to stress is that in the derivation of this propagator, all modes contribute. All longitudinal, time-like, everything propagates in here. And that means that in the loops, if you consider loops of electromagnetic or loops and some electrons coming in, then inside the Feynman diagram, all excitations of this field propagate, not only transverse, but also longitudinal and I cannot kill them, they are there.
Of course.
Yeah, that's the fact of life. Okay, I think that's it for today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So, some questions during the lecture. Maybe if there are some, please.
At the level of idea, why does everything work? You start your talk with the words that we have problems with computation because we had gauge invariants. Okay. Then you deformed your gradient and you eliminated some gauge invariants. But there was still gauge invariants, namely you could shift your. You could take gauge parameters between the image of the box. That's the first question. And another one, could you compare your way of quantizing with another one when you deform your Lagrangian by adding a mass term, which completely eliminates gauge freedom, and so you can mess with the field, you can quantize. Get your physical answers and just read your math. Which way your situation is more correct?
Not better or worse. In both cases, you have to worry about the fact that you still render your quantum theory to be electromagnetism, but not something else. And the fact that at the end of the day, in the quantum theory, the fact that you are dealing with a gauge theory is reflected by the satisfaction of the so-called word identities, or in the general case, word Takahashi identities. So this is something which you have to prove. Otherwise, you don't know if you deal with electrodynamics or not. And these identities is an implication of gauge theory, symmetry in the classical theory, and then it must be also implemented in the quantum theory as a relationship between the correlation functions. And this is something which you have to check a posteriori.
Either in your consideration either
in both.
Okay.
Of course, if you introduce a mass, then you deal with longitudinal polarization from the very beginning. Yes.
Okay. And
that's true. That's another way to quantize.
Okay. And but first question, Thomas Blopani, why everything worked? Because you still had an untrivial kernel.
No, it does not have a kernel. It's invertible. It's completely invertible. And this is an inversion. I can invert it on the blackboard. This is the inverse. It can be inverted in 1 second. Because these gauge transformations are non-generic. This is like you have an infinite dimensional Hilbert space.
But it's still non-trivial functions.
It depends on which class you invert them. If you now have only singular gauge transformations, singular means that they are particular points. The non-generic functions, it's perfectly invertible. My statement is very simple here. You just go to the Fourier transform. And then this operator becomes eta mu mu k squared minus, what was that, k mu, right? This is a kinetic operator written in the, it's an original kinetic operator.
Yeah.
It's an original kinetic operator. Now, in addition to this kinetic operator, you had an extra term, which comes from this lambda minus 1 over lambda, d mu, a mu squared, right? And this term here will be like k squared. Let's see, if I differentiate this with respect to x mu, then I get k mu down. And what I get is here, there will be some addition. So, quite remember exactly what was that, but you remember there was equation of motion which was written like box A nu minus plus lambda minus 1 d nu d mu a nu. So there will be an additional term which looks like lambda minus 1 k nu. And therefore, this expression here will be modified. Instead of 1, there will be some number. Let's call it a standing zero. K nu, right? But it's not 1. A is not equal to 1. And then this operator for any a not equal to 1 is invertible. You can pick up an ansatz for its inversion to be precisely as there, so you can take it to be eta nu lambda minus b k nu k lambda. And now you see, and k squared here, now you see that if you multiply these two, eta mu k squared minus a k nu k nu, and you pair up with respect to this index nu, then let's open everything up. So you get here eta mu. Actually, you need to divide by k squared, right? No, this is your way you do an inversion. So then the first term produces for you lambda mu, eta mu lambda minus a k mu k lambda divided by k squared minus b k mu squared like this divided by k squared. So I multiply this term, this is lambda, right? So I multiply this term by this one and I get k mu k lambda over k squared. So it's k mu k lambda over k squared. The same as here, but with b, k mu k lambda over k squared. And then the last term gives me plus ab k nu k nu gives me k squared and 1 k squared will cancel, and I will left with k nu k lambda over k squared. And now you see that if you want to get delta, to get a theta mu here, so one will be the inverse of the other, you need to satisfy the relation ab minus a minus b is equal to zero. Okay? If I did everything correctly, then this is what you need. So if you satisfy this relation, then these terms cancel, and you get your result. So you can find B from here, right? B is A divided by A minus 1. For A is equal to 1, B is equal to 1. For A is equal to 1, you're in trouble. For any other A, no problem.
Why do we not know that k squared is not zero? Very naive question.
Why it should be zero? It's a four-dimensional k. I'm integrating over it.
So?
Why should it be zero?
Because isotropic vectors in the public space.
No, but you see, I'm integrating over k squared here. So I need to, of course, to put I epsilon. Zero, and this is what we do. This is what I also have to do. Okay. Yeah. Then for real k, I never on the real line, and this is the purpose of putting the I epsilon. That's why we like I epsilon prescription. We move poles away from the integration line.
Feynman boundary conditions.
K square can be zero, but we cannot. We are never on the real line, strictly speaking. So I'm doing here a little bit fast. Okay, but of course you can adjust things, put in I epsilon, everything, believe me.
Okay, let's thank Gleb again. Now we're a bit out of time, but this coffee break, 15 minutes.